wish I can go back to that moment and say, you know what, you're right, I'm going to do exactly what you said. And now I got a whole bunch of messes. Can I just listen? Am I right about that? So what if God is saying the same thing to us? What if God is saying the same thing to the Son? You know what? You really don't discern where you are. And the only way for you to understand what's in you is to see its effect on you in your immature state outside of this place called shadow.
Right.
Let's go. That's a hard thing for a parent. Isn't it? That's a hard thing. You say, you know what? I can only imagine what Moses' mother felt like putting him on that ark, sailing him down the Nile. I can only imagine for you to say, you know what? I love you, but we can't have this here. You know, this thing is getting ready to kill everything that I worked long. Let go.
Yeah.
Yeah? So he lets him go. Now, which one would you want to be right now? The one on your way up or the one sitting up in the house? I need an answer. Huh? One left? You won't stay in that. Stay in that. Stay in that. Stay in the house. Stay in the house. I will stay in the house. Okay. You in the house with your inheritance, but still living with mine. You in the house with your portion that's due you, but you still living off mine. Something wrong with that picture. You got enough to feed you, take care of you, and plant your seed and do your thing, but you still tapping in the mine. That's what you say, labor. No. It ain't as black and white as I'm talking. Y'all into some, I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna stay, I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna stay. Because the leaving and the staying is not the issue. Because neither one of them have discernment of what the good really is.
Right.
Woo!
Yeah.
Okay, hold on. Jeremiah 2:13. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns, that can hold no water.
Yeah.
So understand that you can be in the house and away from God, right? And it's obvious you can be out of the house and away from God, but here is the danger. Whether your state framework, your mind says, I've got to replace this cloud, this shadow that I'm operating in, with something. The one that left the house said, well, I'm going to fill it with riotous living because I can pay for it because I got to get it.
Okay.
Y'all not listen. Come on, y'all. Yeah. Do you understand that when you separate yourself from the fountain, your mind says, I gotta replace the drink with something. For some of us, it's career. It's strokes. To me. It could be a job. It could be a relationship. It could be stuff. But you're trying to feel that thing called shadow that you felt, this thing's going to make me feel more protected.
Right.
So I ain't going to ever run out, so I'm going to have plenty.
Right.
Right. I ain't going to never be broke, so I'm going to make more money, more money, more money, more money. Right. Oh, I can't go to church because I got to be more money, more money, more money. In case I run out, I got to pay more. Now I'm in this thing called, I got a well, and it's broke.
Right.
And it can't hold whole lot. So you know what? Now I'm like somebody on drugs. I got to get a bigger fix. I got to get something that's going to make me feel better. Oh, I got to get another car and another car and another car and a bigger car and a bigger house. And I got to have all kind of plenty of stuff. And I keep doing, and I keep feeding an appetite that was meant for God. And I can't replace God with nothing, so all I can do is look tangible. Lineal, I got to get more stuff to replace this feeling to make me feel like I'm protected and covered. Now, I feel like we've all had God substitutes. But I don't know if we all discern, they all broke. And they're leaking and they can't hold any life. And at some point along the way, you got to say, you know what? I cannot keep replacing God with an imitation. The only thing that's going to satisfy the real longing of my heart is to be in your presence. It's to be in your courtroom. It's to be under the shadow of the Almighty. That's the only thing that's going to satisfy. Are you with me? Come on, I'm ready to go somewhere. I need you to hear where this goes. So you've got the son out of the house. You got a son in the house. They both have goods. But the son says, the one that left the house, he says, I want to spend it. I want to exercise my gifts and my talents. I want to see if I can work this thing. Now understand, everybody in the room has an inheritance. You've got a portion. You've got gifts. You're endowed, right? That thing that God gave you never was for you.
Right.
Did y'all hear me?
Yes, sir.
It ain't for you, it's for us. Huh? And it is not supposed to be used without the relationship with him helping us discern what to do with it. Because to have it without his relationship, we only gonna use it to profit us.
Right.
Y'all didn't get that, did you? When Paul says in Galatians, before he understand, after he got separated from his mother's womb, that Christ would reveal in him, he said, I profited in the Jews' religion. So the grace that was upon his life that was supposed to be for the Gentiles, he used it to profit himself.
Right.
Okay, y'all don't like that.
That's true.
So without God, you gotta feed you. Right? So you never use God's ability for you? Nobody in the room. Thank you. We're not going to answer that question. Woo, come on, keep going. I'm almost there. Okay. Hold this. Whatever God gives us, is God's acknowledgement to us to say, you know what? I so love you. I share all of me with you. For you to take what I give you and don't want me. Now, you know, we have street terms to describe what family.
Yeah.
You don't want me. But you want all I can give. Is there a word for that? You don't have to say it out loud. Huh? So, Jesus gathers. First he sends his 12. Then in Luke 10, he gathers other 70. And he sends them out. He said, I'm going to send you out 2 by 2. That's what I want you to do. I'm going to confer some authority and power upon you. What you hear me say? Raise your hand. Go around the city, find out who's worthy. Preach the gospel. I mean, all these wonderful miracles. I mean, I'm entrusting you with my goods. I'm entrusting you with my authority. I'm entrusting you with my potential. I just want you to go out and represent that. Ooh, Lord have mercy, Jesus. The Bible says those 70 came back and said, Lord, we got some stuff to tell you. This is fact. He said, what's up? He said, Lord, do think I don't know what I gave you works? So you're celebrating the gift that I knew worked, and you miss that it was an indicator that your name was written in heaven. So you celebrating a gift, and I tried to tell you you were in a relationship. That's why the gift works. But that's not what you're rejoicing about. You see how easy it is for us to get twisted in the manifestation of God with no relationship with God? So, here's the question. What value is it to have the Father's goods and you don't know the Father's heart? Is there an answer in the room? None. So, the young son, the Bible says, we're back to Luke chapter 15. Waste all of his inheritance on what the Bible says? Riotous living.
Riotous.
I want you to look at the word that he used here. All right, y'all got a few moments? It must be that. Y'all like, shut the book. Thank you. I appreciate that. Y'all ready? And I like how the Lord used these words, because in this season that we are walking in, this stuff stands out. I'm at 13. Yep. And not many days after, the younger gathered all of his, gathered all together and took his journey into where?
A far country.
So he was away. Now, if you just want to compare apples and oranges, if I'm going to do dirt, I think I will be far away.
True.
I'm just saying, if you're going to do it, you know, that ain't very spiritual. Huh? Right. What do you mean? It's almost as if y'all saying back to me, we ain't going to do no dirt at all. I felt the room across the floor. I don't know if I want to dishonor the house by doing it that close. Huh? Nothing more for a parent than the day we said, you know, we saw your boy down there, we saw your kid down there, and it was just, oh my God.
Right.
They forget what their kids are doing. Their kids was down there with your kid, but it's your kid because you're the preacher. Right. Your child. Right? So, thank you. Somebody could have did about it. So he goes far off, and what's the rest of the verse say? And
there wasted his substance.
Say with me, wasted the substance. Wasted. Okay, so what is he talking about? What did he waste?
His inheritance.
His?
All his stuff.
The goods.
Yeah.
He thinks the goods are the inheritance. Y'all not feeling me yet? Huh? He may have lost the goods, but he don't know what the substance is yet.
Okay.
Woo! I'm just gonna holler by myself right here. What are you talking about? Huh? See, as much as I've given you my stuff, what you hadn't paid attention to, you also got it in impartation of my journey and struggle that acquired the stuff you really think you want, but you actually got more than stuff. You got substance. Ah! What are you talking about? Do you know the story back in Genesis 14 where Abraham goes up against the battle of five kings? And he takes 300 trained men in his house up to this battle that from a natural standpoint looks ridiculous. But the key is they were born and raised in his house and they got hold of some substance that was going to allow them to step into a place beyond their natural ability. Y'all not feeling me. The Bible speaks about a group of women that were around Jesus, right? And they had some issues. Devil cast out of one. This one was sick. This was afflicted. But the scripture said they ministered to Jesus out of their substance. It wasn't stuff that they had. They had substance. When the battle took place between Abraham and Lot, the Bible says that the land was not able to hold them because their substance was great. See, Lot had stuff. Abram had substance. Woo! What are you talking about, preacher? See, the young man got something he was not aware of. And sometimes you don't pay attention to it until you get bottom. So after he wasted all that stuff, then the Bible says he joined himself to a citizen of that country. Now, the citizen of the country discerned, this is an unusual child. He doesn't have nothing, but I feel something when I get around. Kind of like that Joseph thing. Potiphar, you see, you know what? I don't know what it is about this boy, but there's something in me that said, just don't hold him up in jail, but I need to invest some things in him, because everything I put near him, everything that he touched, everything that he sees begins to multiply. Look, you may not know what's in you, but the people of the land recognize you've been raised in another house. Woo! I got some upbringing they ain't seen yet. Something's been done on the inside of me. I might be away from the house, but there's still a hallelujah deep down on the inside of me. Y'all here? Y'all in the room? Woo! Yeah. Okay. Y'all with me? Because I'm getting ready to go to this, going to get juicy now. He is empty, but full. Rock bottom, but about to be set on high. See, that's how God thinks. Let me promote you, let me break you down. Let me increase you, let me break you up. Let me make you the head, be a good team. Want to be above on it? Go through beneath. Well, God, why would you do just the opposite of what you said? Because I'm concerned about people knowing how you got there. And if I just make you rich without you being poor, they're not going to understand where you were when you were desperate. So if I let them see you when you're desperate and then walk them through, now this is what I did along the way. Had nothing. Couldn't see nothing, couldn't believe nothing, but look at what God did. That's the real story. Hello? Now listen, do we all have to come this way? No. But you need to understand the ways of a man, God directs those too. So what if the only way for the younger son to get to his substance was to go through what he went through?
Right.
I know that sounds ugly. That sounds like, but you know what? That is just, why did you want to condone somebody living a sinful lifestyle? Because you don't understand that sinful lifestyle is called to draw a certain people into the kingdom. And without that experience and the testimony that they were in it and done it, there is no power to convince people you can get out of it. See, most of us want to teach people from up here and say, look, you just go do it. You just have it. Some of us have to go through it. Some of us have to be in it. Woo! Come on, tell yourself, I'm about to set myself free today. The way that God is bringing you is the way that God is bringing you. And it's okay. Are y'all all right? Come on. So, okay. Here we go. Here's a word we don't like to use in church. He's about to be exploited. Okay. Is that too offensive? that the man of the land understands that there's something in this son that he can't see, so he exploits him. He puts him to work. It's the lowest job. It is the lowest job. Huh? I've been in one of those. Some of you have been in one of those things. You say, you know what? I'm going to put you on the lowest job possible. Matter of fact, and I'm going to send somebody by to heckle you and humiliate you while you're doing it. Okay. Don't feel good. Until victory belongs to Jesus. Bank knew to send me to that branch where I was going to be the first was going to be a humiliation. They knew the clientele that were going to be in that area. They knew the customers were in there. And they knew that this one, that day, was going to be a setup to come in there and tell me that I was a disgrace and why would the bank hire and put you up in this bank? You ain't ever going to touch my money. But victory belongs to Jesus. By the time the Lord got through with that individual, I was the only one that could touch his money. And the corner that the builders rejected has now become the head of the corner. But you've got to be willing to go through the process. You have to understand, you know what? That you as a forerunner are paving the way for all of those that are coming behind you. And if you don't walk through it, they won't know how to get through it themselves.
Right.
Tell you that, look at him, see ya? You being set up right now. You ready? Come on. 16. And he would fain
had filled his
belly with the what?
The husk of that swine.
Right.
Did eat, and no man gave unto him.
And when he
came to himself, he said, how many hired servants?
Wait a minute. He came to himself. I didn't realize what I left. How many hired servants in my father's house eat good? I gotta get up from here. Y'all been here? I thought they was controlling me. I gotta get up.
Come on.
I thought they were trying to stop me from fulfilling my. I gotta get up in here. I just had a revelation. My well is busted.
Right. Right.
I'm going to my father's. And I'm going to tell my daddy, I am not worthy to be called a son. Huh? Make me like one of your hired servants.
Right.
Are you okay?
Mm-hmm.
See, sonship is not based upon what you do. It's whose you are. I wish the church would get that. Just because you caught up into something, riotous living, whatever you want to fill in the blank, does not change your status of sonship.
Yes, sir.
I wish y'all hear that. Now, this man was how far? Far away. Uh-huh. And we say, well, they just need to get themselves together. Go down through our spiritual deliverance checklist. We're going to receive them back into the house after we have approved that they have stopped doing what they're doing. Have you stopped? And the answer is? Oh, this is the part that I don't. Come on, Elder, tell me what I need you. We're going to have a big old juicy altar call here. Where is the other son?
In the house.
In the house? Right? And let's say that the father is in the house, in the system, in the room called legalism, with the older son. Yep. Until the dispensation of the fullness of time. And the father has discerned that there's a return of the king about. The younger. Now, the son, the Bible says, is a good far way. The father leaves the comfort of the shadow and becomes the way for the one that's far away. Are you talking about? See, Jesus said, I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. That the place was not just for Israel. The place was for Gentiles. He said that I'm going to come and receive you unto myself. Now, I know, watch this. When Jesus must needs go down to Samaria, he knew that woman was never going to come to Jerusalem. So he had to go where she was. Matter of fact, he said, the Father is seeking for true worshipers. And I know you could not discern that was in you by all the stuff that you've been. So I come to find you. In other words, I became the way. I came to where you were, far off. Y'all not feeling me yet. See, what the Father does, he knows that in your mind you've got all these thoughts about how you're going to be received and what's going to go on. Will they accept me? Will they give me? So he'll meet you in your far off place because he discerns something in you has already turned. This is the part that I like. Because we're in this place. Draw me close to you. The father saw him. They're way away from the house. Do you understand? That we think because we're in the house, we have the monopoly of what God is doing. So God said, you don't understand the depths of how much I love the ones that are away. I will become the way. I will leave what you call safety and comfort, and I will find them where they are. And the Bible says, not only did he see him, he read it. Woo! Yeah! Do you know in your situation run after you? How many people have you ever experienced in the middle of your brokenness to say, you know what? I'll risk everything because I feel where you are and what you've been through, and I'll run after you. I'm coming after you. I'm going to find where you are. I know you don't have a whole lot of strength. I know you got some questions. I know you got some concerns. Guess what? I'm not going to wait for you to get to where I am. I'm coming down to where you are. I'm telling you. That woman was in so much stuff. The Bible said she had five husbands. None of them were hers. She was sleeping with somebody else. She was trying to avoid, and Jesus was trying to draw. So he's so pressed. Hear the story. He is so pressed to go down into this area and meet this woman. He says to the disciples, y'all just go on somewhere else. I know y'all can't handle what's about to happen down here. Huh? You're just too critical. You're not going to understand that this woman is in a whole lot of stuff, but she's got a whole lot of substance. Somebody needs to tell her that what's in her is greater than her lifestyle. And I know you can't handle this counseling session that I'm about to have because we're about to go deep. She's coming thinking she's going to get some water, but she is the water. Are y'all feeling me? So this morning, today, we're not done. We're just stopping. I want you to feel the love of God. That he so loves me. That he left heaven, glory. He came to that faraway place where we were. He just came, he ran there. He was full of compassion. And while you're busy trying to tell God what you're in, he steadily put the new robe on. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Come on, this morning, if you are in that faraway place, you're trying to find your way back, he's already in the way. He's already in the way, waiting to receive you. If you're here this morning and you need that contact, draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all.